The beloved Toyota RAV4, owned and loved by people all around the world. Since there have been over 10 million RAV4s produced, the chances are pretty high that either you yourself or someone you know has owned one. Chances are also pretty good that if you speak to any of those owners, you'll find that most everyone only has good things to say about them. And that's true because, for the most part, they are great cars. But there were some problem years and some problem engines throughout the history of the RAV4. In this video, I'll be going through the strengths and the weaknesses of every generation, highlighting the problems you should look out for when buying a used Toyota RAV4. The original concept Toyota RAV4 debuted in 1994 as the first and only small compact crossover. If you've ever owned any crossover or small SUV like the Honda CR-V, the Ford Escape, Hyundai Tucson, Kia Sportage, Mazda CX-3, Nissan Rogue, or even the Subaru Forester, then you can thank Toyota for pioneering the concept. It was way ahead of its time and truly revolutionary, specifically at a time when sedans were all the rage. The RAV4 stands for Recreation Activity Vehicle with four-wheel drive. It was built on the Celica platform, and it had real glass headlights and ended up coming in both the two-wheel drive and the four-wheel drive options. But it wasn't until 1996 that the first production models showed up around the world. The first generation ran between 1996 to 2000. Automobile Magazine named it the Car of the Year, but that doesn't say much, seeing that they also named the dismal Dodge Intrepid as Car of the Year 3 years earlier. And we all know how that turned out. But in the case of the RAV4, it was a much deserved award. It was the perfect car for graduates, first-time car buyers, small families, and the perfect second car. Not many people know that the first gen RAV4 also came optioned as an electric vehicle, but only as a fleet type vehicle and with a limited amount of sales in California only. It had a range of 88 miles. It had a unibody platform and a fully independent suspension. Now, the four-wheel drive model came equipped with a center locking differential as well as a limited differential on the rear axle, making the RAV a capable off-road performer. One of the few problems that this car had were the valve guides. They tended to leak on the first generation, and the way to inspect for that is to look for a small puff of blue smoke on cold startup. Otherwise, it was a reliable little car and quite popular as it turned out. The second generation ran between the years 2001 and 2005. It had a larger engine with an increase in horsepower and it grew in size. The glass headlight lenses gave way to the cheaper and lighter plastic lens, but the main improvements other than size was the addition of an anti-lock brake system, electronic stability control, larger 16-inch wheels, and air conditioning, all of which became standard in the 2001 model. The years 2001 through 2003 had a dependable little 2-liter engine, which was solid. But in 2004, it was replaced by the 2.4 AZ-FE engine, which turned out to be problematic. Now, this engine was a rare instance where Toyota had a faulty design that showed up as the miles piled up, which is why it took so long for the problem to be caught. Turns out that it actually had two problems. The RAVs produced for the North American market had incorrect piston rings, which led to heavy oil consumption. And the second problem was that the engine had weak cylinder head bolts that would strip, creating coolant leaks, which is never good. This engine unfortunately found its way into many cars in the Toyota lineup. There were also some problems with the early years. It was the electronic control module, also known as the ECM, and this was faulty in the 2001 through 2003 years. The car would feel as though it had transmission problems as it would buck and stall. Now, The faulty ECM ended up causing many people to take their cars to transmission repair shops who would replace the transmission, but this of course did not solve the problem. Now in 2004, the RAV4 received a new version of the ECM and it was no longer a problem after that. The 2004 and 2005 years were the very last but the best years of the second generation, mainly due to the new ECM, but also because it had an improved body structure and optional side airbags, which made the RAV4 a much safer car. The side airbags brought the side impact IIHS test scores up from poor to good. The third generation ran between 2006 through 2012. However, there was a very important improvement in 2007 with side airbags now being offered as standard equipment on all models. But it was a mid-cycle refresh in 2009, which is what this is, which vastly improved the RAV in many ways. That makes the 2009 and later models the very best for this generation. Now I want to take a moment and describe the significance of these mid-cycle changes that you see with the entire Toyota lineup. Toyota utilizes the Kaizen method of production, which is constant improvement. In just a few short years, there are so many improvements ready to be implemented that it doesn't even make sense to save these major engineering improvements till the next generation like other car manufacturers do. Toyota makes these improvements with these mid-cycle changes. Now, it's not cheap to do this, but it keeps the problems to a minimum, whereas other manufacturers would let the problem or the older technology ride till the next generation. That can take 4 or 5 years, which is really forever with car manufacturing. In the end, these incremental mid-cycle engineering improvements by Toyota make the car significantly better within a shorter period of time. Nowhere is this more evident than the mid-cycle change in the 2009 RAV4. That was the year that Toyota took the faulty 2.4 AZ FE engine, which was fitted in the earlier models, and replaced it with the new 2.5 engine. It had more power, more efficiency, but most importantly, it went back to the roots of Toyota long-term reliability. There was a notable change in 2010 when Toyota was somehow able to cram a 3.5 liter V6 engine between the shock towers of the RAV4, which made it into an exceptionally quick, compact SUV. It was a true pocket rocket with 0 to 60 times of just over 6 seconds, which makes the V6 model a legitimate sleeper. This engine got mated to a new slick 5-speed automatic transmission to handle all that power, whereas the 4-cylinder had the older 4-speed transmission. 2010 was also the year that Toyota invested $50 million in Tesla. This partnership resulted in a truly amazing RAV4 outfitted with a complete Tesla driveline, including a new age Tesla battery pack. The RAVLA, as I call it, only ran between the years 2012 and 2014. It had about 103-mile range and was incredibly exciting to drive. This relationship between Tesla and Toyota is important to note, since Tesla is the only other manufacturer that I know of that goes to such lengths at improving their cars so quickly. Toyota and Tesla are automotive pioneers instituting substantial engineering changes so consistently and so well. They are two shining stars in the automotive world. There were very few problems in the third generation RAV4. The only complaint that I have seen is the transmission mount, which was prone to failure, which showed up in higher mileage units and more specifically on the strained V6 models. The third generation RAV4 exudes confidence and simplicity. It's about as straightforward as a car can be. So stick with the 2009 through 2012 models, as they're the best years for the third generation. The fourth generation ran between the years 2013 through 2018. It was a complete ground-up redesign. Now, there were many changes which included more of everything, more headroom, more legroom, more loading capacity, and more gears with an all-new 6-speed transmission. Unfortunately, the powerful V6 was dropped, never again to appear in the RAV4 lineup. And the beloved old side hinge door was replaced with a more traditional liftgate. It was 2015 that we saw again a major mid-cycle refresh, which brought a much stronger cabin that could withstand the small overlap crash test. And the crash scores immediately improved, but oddly only for the driver's side, but not the passenger side. Not sure why that was the case. The fourth generation was also when Toyota introduced the popular RAV4 Hybrid in 2016, which borrowed the all-wheel drive system straight out of the Lexus NX300. In 2017, Toyota implemented the Toyota Safety Sense package on all models, otherwise known as the TSSP package. This package was a bundle of active safety features at no extra cost. This includes lane departure alert, automatic high beam, pre-collision warning with pedestrian detection, and Doug DeMuro's favorite feature, dynamic cruise control. I guess Toyota finally decided that safety was no longer just for the people who could afford it, and that's a good thing, and I wish other manufacturers would follow suit. This generation RAV4 is practical, reliable, safe, and very easy to drive. And that's exactly what most people who buy the RAV4 want from their car. On the fourth generation models, I like to try to stick with the 2017 or the 2018 models, as they have the safety features as standard. And finally, that brings us to the fifth generation RAV4, which debuted in 2019, and it's the current generation. New and improved in most every way, looking a lot bolder with angular lines and giving it a more contemporary look. It kept the same 2.5 liter engine from the previous model, but with a generous boost in horsepower. The new engine was mated to an all-new but schizophrenic 8-speed transmission, more on that later. And if you get the hybrid, you actually have the all-wheel drive system with the CVT transmission instead. The newest RAV4, however, is a much more enjoyable drive than the previous generations, and this is mainly due to the new TNGA platform, which is short for the Toyota New Global Architectural Platform, which increased the rigidity of the body as well as lowering the center of gravity. It's absolutely loaded with a suite of high-tech features that come bundled with the Toyota Safety Sense package. The previous generation had this as well, but the new RAV4 has a few more tech features added, like Apple CarPlay for 2019, and then the only difference would be that in 2020, they added Android Auto. In true Toyota fashion, the fit and the finish of the newest RAV4 is the best in the business. The interior has a really nice feel to the cabin with high quality rugged materials evident everywhere. A lot of attention to detail went into the design of the newest RAV4. It just feels incredibly solid. The complaints I do have are the steering, just like all other RAV4s. It's rather dull. But there's also an issue that affects the 2019 and 2020 hybrid model specifically, and that is that the gas tank will not fill up all the way. It seems like Toyota is working on this, and it could be as simple as a software issue, but at the time of this video, it has not been resolved. The 8-speed transmission seems very confused and out of sorts when driving at low speeds. It's as though it cannot figure out which gear is the most appropriate, and this can get really annoying. But get this RAV out on the highway and the 8-speed transmission shines and does exactly what it should with smooth shifting throughout. This is where the 8-speed transmission is at its best. Freeway handling is composed and the ride is smooth and comfortable. Overall, the price point is excellent, especially when you consider all the incredible safety features that come standard for 2020. The verdict is still out on the long-term reliability of the newest generation, but I have no doubt that the newest RAV4, just like all the other generations, will go down in the history books as another solid offering from Toyota. In the future, I expect the sixth generation will once again get back to the electric car roots it had, but now in 2025. It's not a question of if, but when. Maybe they pair up with Tesla again, I doubt that, but it would be a great day to see the return of the electric RAV4, but now with 0 to 60 times in 3 seconds and a 400 mile range. So, to sum up, the best years for the RAV4 are any year on the first generation. On the second generation, the 2004 and 2005 models with the added safety features are the best. The third generation would be the 2009 through the 2012 models, again for the added safety features, as well as the better engine choices, especially if you could get the V6. The fourth generation in between 2017 2018, because of the Toyota Safety Sense package that became standard. And finally, on the fifth generation, if you are an Apple device user, you would go for the 2019 or 2020 with the Apple CarPlay. But if you're an Android user, you would go with the 2020 model, which is when the RAV4 added the Android Auto. So I'm Greg, your car angel. Thanks so much for watching this video. Give it a like if you enjoyed it and subscribe if you haven't done so already. Leave your comments below as I do read them all. And I'll see you in the next video. Take care.